Following two excellent lectures on risks in a broader sense and on pandemics, I would like to delve into actual case studies in a comparative way, which occurred in handling COVID-19 in East Asia. Why Asia, looking from the Central European perspectives? Three major pandemics occurred in the 20th century, the Asian flu in 57, and the Hong Kong flu in 68, inevitably sourced from with roots from Asia. Even the Spanish flu, which killed more people than the First World War, is considered by some scientists originating from China. In the beginning of the 21st century, SARS, the severe acute respiratory disease epidemic, reached southeastern China again, and from there spread to more than 20 countries. Next slide, please. As we can see, among the top countries which were hit by the epidemic was the three countries I'm talking about: Hong Kong, Taiwan, and Singapore. We see here a limited period of the disease from 1st of November 2002 till 31st of July 2003, and the limited number of infected, 8,000 people, and with a death toll of 776. But still, the fatality rate is very high, and it really left a very severe imprint in the societies and governments of those countries and territories concerned. Next slide, please. Especially if we are looking at the situation that many people got infected in hospitals. Looking at Singapore, 41% of the infected cases were healthcare workers, similarly high levels in Hong Kong and considerably high in Taiwan as well. When looking at the duration of the SARS epidemic, as I said, it was limited. It could be declared as closed by July 2003. Still, an academic conference in September 2003, scientists concluded that seldom has intersection between politics, economic development, and public health been more graphically demonstrated as during the SARS. An article in 2004 in an Asian journal referred to this epidemic as China syndrome, citing that public health officers were more concerned about the pandemic disaster that had not happened that time, but it might still. The article answered also the question, why South China? The warm, humid climate with millions of people living in close proximity to pigs, chickens, can result in a leading incubator for new viruses in the world, as I mentioned, happened in 57 and 68 as well. Risk perceptions of these countries have been influenced by this memory in public servants and in the citizens alike, not only by the high fatality rate as mentioned, or by also the serious infections through hospitals. A new minister of health in Taiwan, for example, turned around the situation in April 2003. He was Mr. Chen, who has been, who was the vice president of Taiwan in 2020 at the current outbreak. In April, 90% of the cases came through infections in hospital. The new minister, who was an epidemiologist, trained in the Johns Hopkins University, introduced improved infection control in hospitals, better procedures in emergency room, and universal use of protective gears. Central command central coordination was introduced, and also an island-wide telephone hotline and call center attended by professional doctors and nurses, as well as 100 new fever clinics were at the disposal of the population. In more than a month, the virus was contained, and Taiwan also closed this epidemic period. A major lesson on the public administration level from this SARS 2002-2003 epidemic was to advance and develop the public healthcare system, which happened in all the three areas. And at the same time, they elaborated a very concise pandemic readiness and response catalog of measures, as well as they stockpiled masks and protective garments and equipment for the healthcare workers. As the Prime Minister of Singapore mentioned in an interview end of March, they stayed alert during the 17 years ever since. So what are the common features in these countries, how they reacted? Next slide, please. First of all of them are living in high-risk areas. For example, Taiwan had 12 flights per day to Wuhan. Singapore flights were flying also daily to Wuhan when the outbreak emerged. And they immediately responded to the situation already beginning of January, put in place protocols, distributed resources to hospitals, practitioners, although the first cases emerged only on the 22nd, 23rd January in all the three. So altogether, we can summarize that they successfully managed the first wave. They had hardly 100 cases within the first 1.5 months before the global pandemic. Kösona, thank you. So among the common features, we can also talk about the fast and early and decisive reaction of these countries. What can I say about fast and early reaction? When Taiwan, where we can repeat that the vice president was an epidemiologist, was informed about the outbreak in China on 31st of December, when the first flight was landed, public health officers entered the flight and screened all the passengers and those who were suspicious were sent into special hospitals already prepared for this purpose. Singapore put together the inter-ministerial task force before the first case was registered from various ministries, headed by the Minister of Health. Protocols were put in place. Taiwan, in the first week, first five weeks, introduced 124 measures. What happened in Hong Kong? Hong Kong, on the 4th of January, already introduced its emergency disease prevention level. And 8th of January brought laws about allowing for this particular disease introducing quarantines. So the second major issue is a transparent and regular communications. Daily press conferences in Taiwan started already early in January before the first case emerged. And during the most difficult times with the global pandemic, 3 press conferences were held daily. Singapore makes all persons infected keeping detailed on the website of the Ministry of Health, also stating in which geographical area from which source they got infected, although they are anonymous, but those people who were in the neighborhood can be reached partly by contact tracing, but also following this information can realize that they were in the neighborhood of someone infected. And Singapore is really mastering contact tracing. By mid-March, 40% of the patients who didn't develop the symptoms were already reached through the efficient contact tracing measures. We know that all the 3 countries has a very advanced IT service sector, which encouraged the countries to put in place IT applications for this fight. This definitely caused privacy concerns among the population. Let me mention the case of Singapore, which developed by March already the contact tracing trace together application, but still by mid-September, only roughly 40% of the population was ready to download on their mobile phones, avoiding that privacy matters are hurt by these applications. When global pandemic was declared by WHO on 11th of March, all the countries and territories declared travel bans and introduced travel bans for the global travelers and also quarantine for their returning visitors. The results of the 8 months show finally, in global terms, very good results. Can we see the slide with the results? Yeah, so it really shows that how the number of cases are relatively very low in Taiwan. I will come to Singapore of the high number of cases, but still we can see that luckily the number of deaths is very small. In Hong Kong, for the 7.5 million population, we see a total cases of 5,000. Today with 10 new cases and altogether 105 people died. So what are the differences in handling this situation in the 3 countries? In Taiwan, the excellent management of the situation has also included a synergetic discourse between government and civil society in the 24 million country, showing an incredibly good result with altogether 513 registered patients. Taiwan calls itself as a mask society, as after the 2003 SARS epidemic, the civilians kept on wearing masks when the first symptom of a flu appears either at home or when they are abroad. So Taiwan was producing masks daily, 1.8 million. But they immediately realized in January that in spite of the fact that the WHO didn't suggest that time wearing masks, they put their efforts on it. With the common efforts with several local manufacturers of masks and manufacturers of production lines, which are producing the lines, with government help, and in a kind of a public-private partnership, they increased the production of masks to 20 million by day for by May 2020. From the very beginning, they started to ration masks to the population. In the beginning, two per week per person, and from March, nine for 2 weeks for each person. And also civic tech organizations helped to overcome the long queues in pharmacies and develop applications for online registering for the mask or seeing where there are stockpiles and how to avoid queues. So government and civil society and business collaborated in this effort. The elections in May 2020 in Taiwan confirmed with a landslide victory the president, which also was a kind of a bonus or a reward for the handling of the situation. Special cases and specialties of Singapore, we can mention the fact that from the beginning of 2003, Singapore started to develop the biotechnological industry and biomedical research. Today they are producing large numbers of test kits and exporting that as well, and they are part of the vaccine development. The excellent results till mid-March in Singapore were followed by challenges for the global tourist and business hubs when it became a global pandemic. By travel bans and quarantines, this situation was also solved. Schools and businesses were kept in open until 9th of April. And Singapore's controversial issue started from the beginning of April, when they, the government and the coordination, somehow oversaw the danger and the risk of overcrowded, privately run dormitories of migrant workers. They had to close the businesses, schools for 2 months and cost the economy on the country a lot for this oversight. It took 4 months until they could keep to get the situation under control with a special task force. But we have to mention that those 300,000 people who were strictly quarantined, and although they saved from a death from COVID-19 due to the free of charge good healthcare treatment, but several of them had stronger frustrations and psychiatric issues with some suicides. The quality of the healthcare system is shown that out of the 57,000 registered cases, 27 died in Singapore. Hong Kong reacted fast. However, their methods was an immediate lockdown. Schools, businesses closed from end of January. People worked from home. Digital education was introduced, and that kept the situation under control. Controversy was caused by the fact that they didn't really close the borders with China, which arose negative sentiments with the population and the society. 6,000 medical workers protested for 5 days strike between 3rd and 7th of February in order to force the chief officer of Hong Kong to close the open borders. Hong Kong by June already achieved a situation when there were no new cases, when in July there was a ramping up of the new cases through a so-called third wave after the travel second wave has occurred everywhere due to loopholes in the quarantine regimes, the personnel from the ships from the sea were entering without any control the island. The government's mass testing efforts in May also was followed by negative sentiments, as they found the population found it unnecessary to invite Chinese team to take these measures. They were afraid of collecting data. So privacy issue is also a very strong concern in Hong Kong. If we go back to the slide with the kids, please, this slide, we can see that Taiwan is the only one which has never closed its education. It is very nicely introduces precautionary measures, but we see on the slide how children are eating for the rest of the day. They are wearing masks during all the lessons. Well, when the pandemic fight is still going on, scientists and consultants in Asia are drawing the attention on further risk and dangers. Next slide with the map, please. The ecological threat register shows the number of ecological threats faced by countries in 2020 and suggests that Asia may come up in the forefront to give answers to challenges. Thank you for your attention.